Hey everyone, Hewy here. Welcome to Hewy's Animated Movie Views, the show where I review animated films from old to recent, whether they're hand-drawn, stop-motion, or computer-generated. Yeah, as you can see by the opening shot, I'm flying my house again. But this time, I'm not going to Paradise Falls. Instead, I'm going to look for Halley's Comet in the very depths of outer space! It's part of the movie that's featured in today's episode. But for a movie like this, I'm going to need some help. So, live via satellite, I give you my co-host for today, a fellow reviewer and a new friend of mine. Please give it up for Jaimetud!
Hey folks, my apologies for the video quality ahead of time. How's the reception coming in there, Hewy?
It's coming in good, dude. Thanks for co-hosting this episode with me.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me. So, what's today's movie?
First off, let's talk about two of the most famous people in history. Let's start with stop-motion animator Will Vinton.
Oh, Will Vinton. Yeah, the guy's awesome. I did a review series not too long ago highlighting some of his TV specials. Will Vinton is considered one of the most influential people in the world of claymation. He got an Academy Award for his short film Closed Mondays, and since then has established a career that spanned across several decades animating for feature films, TV shows, commercials, and my personal favorite, Will Vinton's Claymation Christmas.
Two of his most famous creations are the Noid, the mascot for Domino's Pizza, and the California Raisins, used in commercial for said products during the 1980s.
That's correct. And our other historical figure is?
American author Mark Twain. Best known for writing such classics as Tom Sawyer, Huck Finn, and The Prince and the Pauper, as well as being a friend to presidents, artists, industrialists, and European royalty. Twain was very popular, and his keen wit and incisive satire earned praise from critics and peers. Upon his death, he was lauded as the greatest American humorist of his age, and William Faulkner called Twain the father of American literature.
Interesting bit of trivia about Mark Twain was that on November 30th, 1835, the night he was born, Halley's Comet appeared in the night sky. It also appeared in the night sky around the time of his death on April 21st, 1910.
So, what do Mark Twain and Will Vinton have in common?
Well, there was a movie made back in the 80s that celebrated the works of Mark Twain.
And that's the subject for our view today. Released in March of 1985, the movie is The Adventures of Mark Twain.
The film starts out with scrolling text informing the viewers of Twain's relationship with Halley's Comet.
You know, a lot of famous people were born on the same year or day as something equally famous. I, for instance, was born the same year the Berlin Wall fell, and 3 days after the Tiananmen Square protests in China. And heck, Abraham Lincoln and Charles Darwin were born on the same day of the same year!
Awesome. And I was born the same year that George Orwell warned everybody about, on the same day as Wesley Snipes. That's like 5 awesome storylines in a row right there.
Moving on. We then pan into someone's billiard room.
It's space!
Inside, a book opens up to reveal...
See, that's why I could never get through reading The Tempest.
We then cut to two of our main protagonists, who are the most famous of Twain's creations, Tom Sawyer and Huck Finn. Surprisingly enough, on a raft in a river.
When Tom hears news about a hot air balloon in town, he hatches one of his great schemes to get famous and decides to use said balloon to chart the skies, apparently not knowing that it was already done centuries ago by astronomers. Tom and Huck head into town to see that Mark Twain is planning to use it to chase after Halley's Comet.
Wait a minute! Wait a minute! Tom Sawyer meeting Mark Twain. A fictional character meeting the author who created him. How is that possible? That's like Shakespeare meeting up with Romeo and Juliet and telling her to hook up with Hamlet instead. Give me one good reason how this could possibly ever happen.
Magic.
Well, Mr. Bean knows all. I'd also like to mention that that's the voice of the late James Whitmore, the actor who played Brooks in Shawshank Redemption. But I think he does an even better job here as Mark Twain.
Yeah, I like the delivery of his elderly southern accent, giving the character an adventurous feel to him. Kind of like Carl Fredrickson in Up, an old man, but one who has seen and done practically everything.
Anywho, our two would-be explorers sneak aboard the balloon, followed by a curious Becky Thatcher, when suddenly the balloon takes off. But upon discovering the three stowaways, Mark Twain is surprisingly cool with them being there.
So, yeah, Mark Twain doesn't mind his new passengers aboard the voyage. I guess he just loves kids. Anyway, he tells them his desire of catching Halley's Comet. Tom, eager to be a world-famous aeronaut, volunteers to help Twain accomplish his goal.
But in the meantime, let's hear Mark Twain tell a story about the jumping frog of Calaveras County.
Ooh, let's!
The segment retells an original Mark Twain story of a frog that could jump farther than any other frog in the county and his rather gamble-happy trainer.
From a technical standpoint, I love the effect of how the frog jumps. If you put it in slow-mo, it starts out with a clay frog, and as it jumps into the air, it slowly switches to a glob of green clay to give off the illusion of speed. Now that's clever.
That'd be what they like to call squetching in this business.
For those of you who don't know, squetching is a combination of the words squash and stretch. In today's world of computer animation, animators are blessed with the simplicity of motion blur effects to achieve movement. However, in the olden days, squashing and stretching characters was a commonly used way of depicting rabbit movement.
So, long story short, the trainer bets a stranger against his frog in a race and loses thanks to a dirty trick. I've not read Twain's story this was based on before, but something tells me this trick didn't involve a frog swallowing an entire 49ers backpack worth of supplies.
Wow, that frog has some stomach to hold that much stuff inside. What a rotten trick! Anyway, after the story, Mark reminisces about the day of his birth when Halley's Comet flew by.
Still, Tom and Huck try to hatch a plan to get Mark Twain to land up.
Tom, where are you going?
This thing's really amazing.
Gives me the creeps.
Okay, that's got to be the coolest, weirdest elevator I've ever seen.
Yeah, it is. I mean, you could just walk through solid matter, and instead of just floors, it also goes into different Mark Twain novels. For example,
I reckon I'm getting...
Ah!
Close it, Tom!
That was messed up.
That's nothing. Wait till you see later on in the movie.
Let's move on.
Our young heroes catch up with Twain in his billiards room where we get to hear the story of Adam and Eve.
Mark Twain never wrote that story. It was already written. In the Bible!
Huh. It's not quite the version I remember either.
Well, Mark Twain does do something different. In this version, the story is told from the diary entries of both Adam and Eve, who just can't stand each other.
For some reason, Eve reminds me of Jane Goodall.
Adam just wants to relax while Eve tries to set rules and laws in the garden. Hey, I'd hate her too if I just wanted to enjoy my paradise.
Well, you know what they say. Behind every strong man is a strong woman. I've actually read that this segment was created early on just to get investors interested in making the movie.
And when Adam tells Eve not to pluck the apples from the tree for it would mean certain death, she's all for the idea! Why? Why does she want to kill everything in paradise on purpose? Is she that demented?
Come on, Hewy. Bitches be crazy.
Harley Quinn's escaped!
Seal all exits!
Maybe she went down the laundry chute.
None of these yahoos are crazy enough to pull that old stunt.
Huh? Help, help, Harvey, anybody, get me out of here!
The thrilling story of Adam and Eve is cut short when the balloon hits one heck of a storm. I really can't find a good joke to crack at this. It just looks too awesome.
Yeah, it does. Anyway, during the storm, Tom thinks he sees a mysterious figure in black conducting the storm with his hands.
Wow, it took you mentioning that to get me to notice it. He must be taking lessons from Yensid.
The balloon crashes against the side of a mountain, tearing off a huge chunk of the cabin in the process. Luckily, Twain steers the balloon above the clouds, safe from the storm below.
As deckhands, you've got a lot to learn. Of course, training is everything. I mean, a cauliflower is just a cabbage with a college education.
Oh dear, Grandpa's got dementia. He thinks he's in the grocery store talking to vegetables again.
Later on, the crew heads back into an elevator where they run into... Hey, wait a minute. Mark Twain had an emergency costume change, it looks like.
Twain then presses a button titled Mysterious Stranger, where they are greeted by... a mysterious stranger, wearing medieval armor and holding a mask on a stick to use for a face.
Pretty creative. I wonder who this guy is.
An angel.
What's your name?
Satan.
Could you repeat that?
Satan.
Dude, did he just say... Satan?
You heard the man.
You're telling me that this dude is Satan. Lucifer. Beelzebub. The Prince of Darkness. In other words, the freaking devil? No, that's actually an interesting design for him. And in a subtle way, it's really scary. I like this design. Forget Chernabog or Tim Curry from Legend. This dude is the one true Satan. I mean, he said it himself that he's an angel. And what is the devil?
A fallen angel? Little known fact, though, this scene is typically cut from the TV broadcast, but I think it also renewed interest in the movie on YouTube because thanks to those guys, it was the first scene I ever saw. And it made me want to know what the heck Mark Twain is doing introducing those kids to Satan.
He's not a children's author, dude. He's just an author. No particular age group, just an author.
Yeah, but that's still Satan.
Let's just continue. The kids soon enter Satan's universe, which I guess is supposed to be a version of hell. That's a scary thought. There, Satan creates a small kingdom and asks the kids to sculpt people out of clay.
Then, to make matters sadistic, Satan brings the little clay people to life and gives the kids a rather harsh lesson in life. I'm disturbed. What say you?
I think he describes the devil perfectly well. An all-powerful, mysterious being who hates mankind and wants to see them destroyed, spreads hatred and fear throughout the world, feeds off their anger and greed, and delights in torturing their souls as punishment for their vile acts, which he made them do in the first place.
Amen to that.